and this one right before the T, right? So let me give another scenario. Imagine you are living in a country like India and city like Chennai. What do you think about the diabetes? What age diabetes generally come? What is our belief?
Sugar.
What age yeah, diabetes sugar?
40 plus maybe.
40 plus. Now I want to make a statement. People become diabetes in the age group of 20 to 30 itself. Is it believable?
Yes. No, you have to take a sample.
It is not believable. So my statement is alternate hypothesis. Clear? I am saying that people in Chennai in the age group of 20 to 30 have started becoming diabetic. So they must test for diabetes right at the age of around 20, and they have to take medicines if they are found diabetic. So this is a new finding, a research finding. No? And this is actually an alternate hypothesis. If alternate hypothesis is understood, what is null hypothesis? Alternate hypothesis is people are diabetic in the age group of 20 to 30. Then what is alternate null hypothesis?
No.
Come on.
No.
20 to 30 or 40.
They are not diabetic. 20 to 30, they are healthy. That is what we all believe. What we all believe without any, you know, asking for any proof, that is null hypothesis. We all believe that we are all healthy. Particularly in the age group of 20 to 30, we don't get diabetic. That is our belief. So our sugar levels are expected to be 90 to 100. Do you understand? Our sugar levels are expected to be or believed to be in the range of 90 to 100. We are all very healthy. Do you see an equality symbol in the statement? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So that is why we call null hypothesis is always statement of equality. But I now a doubt raised because some researcher has told that nowadays, you know, many people are diabetic because there are other symptoms coming on. They get, you know, their eyesight is going down. They are getting tired. There are a lot of symptoms. So the suspect is people are becoming diabetic in the early stage itself. So I want to do a hypothesis testing. Now tell me, sugar level, is it a continuous data or discrete data?
Continuous
data. It is measurable. You can take a blood sample, send it to lab, and they will tell you your sugar level. Right? So it is measurable. It is continuous data. And what is your population? What is your population? People living in Chennai. People in the age group of 20 to 30. How many people could be there in the age group of 20 to 30 in Chennai, in India? How many?
There are more.
Tell me some rough number, maybe. Some 5 million? 10 million?
Yeah, 10 million.
Okay. So can you study everyone's blood? Can you take a blood sample from all 10 million or 20 million people and do a study?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Then how will you validate?
We'll take some group of...
Yeah, you will do a sampling. Now, how will you take sampling? Which sampling technique will you use? Will you go for a random sample? Will you go for stratified? Will you go for a cluster? Would you like to cover all the regions in Chennai? You would like to take sample only from the central portion of the Chennai?
All the regions of Chennai.
All the region. Then your data is stratified. Then your sample is a stratified technique. Maybe you might divide the Chennai into north, south, you know, and central Chennai. And then you will preferably take sample from all areas so that you can make a statement about the Chennai. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
You have to have some knowledge on, you know, how you can go wrong and then try to prevent it. That is called, you know, research. And now, let us say your strength is limited. You can study only 1,000 people. You can study only 1,000 people because your budget is limited, isn't it? Because every blood sample test will cost you money. So 1,000 sample you have taken and now 1,000 readings are available. How will you make a conclusion like the Sanjay Singh You should also now use the average, am I right? Now you are using continuous data. You are using statistics called average. You have taken a sample of 1,000 people and trying to predict, judge on the 20 million population. What is this study? What is this? Is it a study of mean or proportion? Test of mean.
Mean, sir.
Test of mean. Test of mean, how many testing you have? You have Z-test?
T-test.
T-test.
You have two sample T-test. You have ANOVA.
ANOVA.
Now, what is this coming under? Is it Z-test or T-test?
Z-test, sir.
When we go for Z-test?
When there is a population against sample.
No. When the population data is available.
Population data is.
Some data about the 20 million people.
FD is available.
Do you think the data about 20 million people is available with you?
No, sir.
Not available. Then how can you go for Z-test?
I have to go for T-test, sir.
Yeah, if you don't have food in your house, then you have to order in Swiggy or Zomato. Whenever that is not possible, go for the T. Right? Population is unknown population. Such a study has not been conducted earlier. And you don't have access to the information. The population standard deviation is not known. So this leads to a testing called one sample T-test. Clear? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Studied to understand the population. And now, the statistics that is going to help you with your decision is average. Average value of the fasting blood sugar. Fasting blood sugar is one way you can understand whether a person is diabetic or not. There are many ways. You can do the right one during the real study. Now for discussion, I want to limit the discussion. Only fasting blood sugar and average is used. Now significance level must be defined. Because people will ask, when you want to publish your paper in a journal or you want to publish in some platform, a social platform, then they will ask you, what is your level of significance in the study? Or what is the confidence level in your findings? And minimum general standard is 95%. That means level of significance is 5%. Understood? This is a fixed value. You have to fix it before starting your research. And now, rejection criteria. Now tell me, what is the preferred range to consider a person as non-diabetic?
90 to 100.
Suppose if your sample reading says 101, do you consider that person as diabetic? Suppose one day you take your sugar level, your reading is 100.3. Do you think you have become diabetic? Because the increase of 3.
No. Borderline case.
Borderline case. If you cross the border, then only you will get a special treatment. Am I right? You cross the India border one time, you see what happens. You will get a special treatment, right? They will not allow you to. Same way, borderline cases, we will not take decision based on the borderline cases. 100.3 is borderline, 100.1 is borderline, 100.2 is borderline. 105, what do you think? Is it still a borderline?
No, sir.
I think so, become serious for you, isn't it? So, doctors don't take decision when your readings are slightly going up. They'll still be tolerant. They will probably ask you to maintain some good diet and other things and ask you to come for the next week because they will not immediately prescribe the medicine. But sometimes if your readings are 110, doctor will not wait. He will tell you, gentlemen, you have become diabetic. Please start taking the medicine right from today. Otherwise, you will be, in the risk of so many other consequences. You understand? So you should know exactly where the border ends. And if the border ending line is known, if your statistics goes beyond the border, you will consider the situation as critical. You will take decision and you will reject your innocence. You will reject your null and start believing the alternate. And right now, in order to simplify, I am telling you the boundary value. You see, range of 90 to 100, that means target is 95. How do I get the target? The center value, 95. Target is 95, but the border ends, or the suspect of doubt ends at 111.45. When your sugar level goes above 111.45, it is sure that you have become diabetic. How did I get this value? 95% confidence limit. My 95% confidence limit ends at 111.45. How do I get 95% confidence limit? Target plus 1.96 times standard error that has been taught yesterday evening. You don't have to do every calculation manually, but you should know. When you use the softwares to give you the analysis, you should not become a slave for the software. You must make the software work as a slave for you. For that, you must learn all these things. So 111.45. Imagine you have taken a reading blood sample of 1,000 and the average of the blood sample, 1,000 samples, is found to be 115.3. Now come on, tell me, what do you think? Come on, students. Now, sample average is 115.3. Is that borderline crossed or not crossed? Borderline crossed. So what did the sample say? Sample is giving a signal that people in Chennai in the age group of 20 to 30 become diabetic. How do you say? The sample is speaking. Sample information, signal from the sample cannot be ignored. Why? Because it has crossed the boundary. If it has not crossed the boundary, I will still ignore. Hey, so maybe by mistake, yeah. But by mistake, the value cannot go this much, isn't it? It is not by mistake, it is intentional. Whether it is due to an error or is that really the process has changed, that is understood if the calculated statistics goes beyond the reference value. This is called calculated statistics. This is called table statistics. Have you studied calculated Z-score compared against the tabulated Z-score? Am I right?
This is a calculated value.
Whenever the calculated value goes beyond the table value, the study is giving a significant information. You cannot ignore the study. The difference observed in your statistics is now significant. The factor is critical, right? And so the decision arrived is reject the null. Why did I reject the null? My sample statistics crossed the
borderline.
So, final conclusion, when they reject the null, what is your null? People are healthy. But what is then alternate? When null is rejected, what is left with you?
Alternate value.
Alternate. Now, people are diabetic is the alternate. Because you studied about 1,000 people, would you advise all 20 million people to take medicines next day onwards?
No, sir.
So rejecting the null doesn't mean accepting the alternate. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
I only say reject the null. If you still want to accept the alternate, you want everybody to take the medicine, what will you do? You will ask everybody to do a blood testing. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
That is called further experimentation. After hypothesis testing, further experimentation have to be studied to understand the fact about alternate hypothesis. If all 20 million people take the blood test and if the readings are really beyond the limit, each one will start taking medicine. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
But without doing tests, nobody will take medicines. So null hypothesis is limited to decision only about null. It is now you have come to the decision, come to the fact very close. What is the fact very close? alternate may be correct, but null is definitely wrong. Null wrong doesn't mean alternate is correct. In order, if you want to say null is wrong, hypothesis testing is enough. If you want to say alternate is correct, you must do further experimentation. You must do further investigation. A detailed experimentation is called design of experiments. A detailed study is called what? Design of experiments or designed experiments. Me and Dr. RK can do a 2 days training program on design of experiments. You can master that. Design of experiment is an important tool in the packet of a black belt. So you will learn that in the next level. I don't recommend that black belt right now to you. You are still a student. Green belt itself is good enough. Do the project, grow in your career. Then for further growth, whenever you feel comfortable, try to become a black belt, right? And you should be competent to join a black belt program. All right. And some of you, one of you asked it, right? See here, the same problem I have visualized. The blood sugar level, average blood sugar level is 95. Now, I want you to make an assumption that population standard deviation is not known to you. When population standard deviation is known to you, you can go with Z test. If it is not known to you, you will go with T test. Very good. Now, I am making an assumption. Population standard deviation is known 10 years before somebody has done the study. And then they have given me and standard deviation is known. And now I have drawn a line. What is the area to the right side of the line? Come on, yeah, please be fast. 11:45, I have to hand over to Dr. Arki. Another 15 minutes. Please be fast. What is the area to the right side of the line?
Diabetic patient.
What is the area under the curve on the right side of the center line? What is the total area always?
100.
Probability. What is the total probability?
50/50.
Total probability is one. Am I right? Total. Have you studied probability, all of you? Total probability of all possible events is always one. What is the chance of failing in the exam? Chance of failing in the exam is 70%. What is the chance of passing the exam? 30%. What is the chance of failing and passing? 100%. Always, if you include all possible events, the total probability is 1. The total area under the curve can be considered as 1 or 100%. When I say 1, draw a center line, 1 will divide into 0.5 and 0.5. Am I right? 50% on the right, 50% on the left. Did I teach you normal distribution is symmetrical at the center?
Yes, sir.
Symmetrical means 50% on the right side, 50% on the left side. So center is 95. So the chance that sugar levels can go above 95 is 50%. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, what is the Judd score when my sample reading is also 95? Sample reading is 95. Expected target also 95. The formula is mean minus, sample average minus target divided by error. What is the formula for Judd score? Difference in the average divided by error. What is the difference in the average? What is the sample average? 95. What is the target? 95. How much is the difference?
0.
So divided by standard error, divided by any number, that will be 0. When your sample statistics is here, exactly at the center, Judd score will be 0. When Judd score is 0, probability of Judd equal to 0 and above equal to 0.5. Probability of Judd equal to 0 and above is equal to probability of X equal to 95 and above. Am I right? See, I don't teach all these things even in a corporate training program. I am teaching because I believe that you are all students. You all can follow me. Am I right? Many people think that no, students can't understand all these things. But I strongly believe that only students can learn all these things.
Yes, sir.
So, these statements are same. Right. Next situation. The line has moved from 95 to maybe some 105. what will happen to your z-score? Will it increase or decrease?
Increase.
Will increase. When z-score increases, when z-score increases, what will happen to the p-value? Earlier, from here up to infinity, the area was 0.5. But now from here up to infinity, what will be the area? Will decrease. Very good. Very good. That's what I want to know. Now your line, your blood score, your value further goes. For someone, the blood sample is giving a reading of 111.4. Blood sample is giving a reading of 111.4. I consider 111.4 as borderline. You know why I consider that as borderline? Beyond which it is red color area. The last 5% of the people will have sugar level in this range. These people are considered diabetic in the medical world. And then medicines are sold to these people. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Last 5% of the outputs are always considered worst. The last 5% of the students' marks are considered poor. Am I right? If I conduct the test, last 5% of the students, they scored only around 50 to 55. Can I consider their performance as worst? Am I right? So this region is considered region of significance. If anybody falls here, he will be investigated. If any data falls here, that will be investigated. Because the chance for your data to appear here in the red color area is maximum 5%. That is fixed as level of significance. Now, moving further. When z-score is more than 5, that means... p-value for your x more than 111.4 is limited to 0.05. Your z-score will be not be 0 now. Z-score will be 1.645. I will tell you how it is 1.645 slightly later. And now, suppose you observe your reading 115.3. What does it mean? Your sample is giving a significant information. Why do I call it significant information? Your sample falls under the worst output. The last 5% of the cases, the last 5% of the cases are considered the diabetes by patients in the medical world. Whether diabetes exists or not, but people are calling them as diabetic. Right? And medicines are served. And see, how do I know that people have become diabetic? How do I know that the population has become worse? Now look at the area for this. The yellow colored area, is it less than 5%?
Definitely. 5%. Definitely.
But this area is less than 5%. This yellow colored area is now called the p-value. Alpha is always 5%. Alpha you are seeing in red color. P-value you are seeing in yellow color. Whenever your yellow color is less than the red color, study is significant. Factor is critical. Your process is deteriorated. Changes are required in the process. You can now differ from the average professionals in the company. That is why you are called green belt. Understood?
Yes, sir.
This yellow region is less than 0.05. Do you now understand why do we reject the null? P value is less than 5%. Is it very lengthy statement to say yes? Yes. Right? That is why we are rejecting, right? So, in a Z distribution, for a one-tailed test, that score will be 1.645. 1.645 is the converted value of 0.4 in this example. Not only in this example, any project, any data, when you convert this point, that will become 1.645. That is why in order to solve a problem of any industry, we need to master normal distribution, particularly standard normal distribution. Standard normal distribution can only give you this value of 1.645. These values can be different. Blood sugar level is this value. Your height will be different value. Weight will be different value. Product dimension will have different value. Hardness will have different value. But everything when converted, will become 1.645. That is the beauty of normal distribution. All the problem in the world can be converted into a statistical problem of z-score. Right? And now, whenever z goes beyond 1.645, p-value will go below 5%. Now it is in your hand. compare the ZAT score against table score. If ZAT, if your calculated ZAT score is more than the table score, reject the null. I give alternate method. Calculate p value is less than 5%, you reject the null. Which is easier for you? You want to refer to the table or simply look at the p value?
Looking p value.
Very easy. Nowadays, nobody works with the old fashion. Isn't it? Now, you see, all of us adopt the latest trend, isn't it? Same way, p-value is the latest trend. Nobody nowadays refers to the table at all. That and all days are gone. Probably RKSR could have used all those things. I don't know. He could have, would also have changed it now, right? So, you all can use p-value. P-value is the risk of observing the data due to random chance. Can one of you read out the difference? Can one of you read out the statement? One of you read it out loudly.
A difference to be a difference must make a difference in real life.
Once again.
A difference to be a difference must make a difference in real life.
Very good. This is what B value is telling you. If you see your six skill levels have really improved because of the training program, that should reflect in your interview. Am I right? This is what you're trying to find out. This is what we are trying to find out in the p-value, right? Simply, I attended the training program. I have a certificate, but I am still, same level. I'm not able to generate a job. That means your certificate is a paper. Green belt certificate should not be used as a paper. Green belt certificate should be used for creating your job offer. Now tell me, who is going to create the job offer? Do you think MSME will create the job offer?
Sure, sir.
It is in your hands. Certificate is in your hand. You have another responsibility to create the job offer for yourself, right? Don't trust anybody. If somebody says they will give you the job, they are simply cheating you. Am I correct? Yes or no? Do you think somebody will type the job offer for you and then bring and give it to you in a sealed cover?
No, sir.
No, sir.
That is not true. That job, you will not survive. If somebody pushes things and gets you a job offer, I'm sure you will work there for not more than 3 months. You will immediately come out. But if you generate a job offer, I can see you as a CEO of the same company. Right? Always. So all that you have mastered, see here. Whether the problem is related to any variable of interest, not only fasting, blood sugar, product dimension, customer satisfaction, hardness, surface finish, let it be any problem, students marked, or the training effectiveness, any problem can be converted into a score with ZAT. That score will tell the fact whether the training is effective or not. Everything can be assessed in the form of hypothesis testing. You can use the knowledge gained to solve any problem in the world. 95% of the problem in the world can be solved simply by mastering one distribution, which is called a normal distribution, right? Read well about the normal distribution and you will be distinctly better than others. Like the values will differ for a one-tailed test, for a level of significance of 5%, that score will be 1.645. Reference value is 1.645. Suppose if it is, for a two-tailed test, reference value changes. For one-tailed, it is 1.64. For two-tailed, it is 1.96. Clear? And then if the level of significance is 1, the ZAT score will change. You don't have to remember all these things because every time the p-value is there to help you. You don't remember all these things. 5% level of significance means p-value should be less than 5%. 1% level of significance means p-value should be less than 1%. Or 10% level of significance means p-value should be less than 0.1. The table is there. Take a screenshot, use it, but you really don't have to go through all these painful steps. You can compare with the p-value. P is low, reject and null. In order to make you remember, I have made a rhyming statement here. P is low, null will go. P is high, null will stay. That means when P is less than 5%, reject the null. Conclusion is, factor has a significant impact on the Y variable. Criticality is proved. When P is high, factor has no impact on the Y variable. There will be difference in the statistics, but practically there is no impact. when you are dealing with average, you have this many tests. One sample Z test, one sample T test, one sample, two sample T test, and ANOVA. You have understood all those things. When you are dealing with proportion, you have one proportion test, you have two proportion test, and you have chi-square test. You may also deal with the variance. What is variance? Square of standard deviation. Sigma square is called variance. Whether the variances are equal or not, how did you check whether average are equal or not, which average is bigger, same way whether variances is equal or variances is high, that is called F test. When you compare variance of two groups, that is called F test. When you compare variance of more than two groups, you have two options. Anything can be used. It is called either Bartlett or Levin group. Sometimes in order to generate the solution, for example, in the improve phase, you have to generate the solution. If you want to generate the solution, you should not only understand the criticality, you should also understand the relationship. Why should you understand the relationship? I want to control the Y. If I want to control the Y, I will control the X. For example, I think RK will permit me to use this example. Dr. RK is there. If I want to control Dr. RK, you know what should I do? I will speak to his wife. Am I correct? Because he obeys completely. Right? Same way, your Y is found to obey the X. So I will change the X. What will happen to the Y? Y will change. What is the relationship? Is it positive or negative? I am going to teach you right now today, correlation and regression. Right?
No, sir.
The relationship is understood. You can do well in the improve phase. Your analysis will be a full-fledged analysis if you not only understand the criticality, but also understand the relationship. Relationship and the amount of influence X has got on Y. For example, if I ask one of you, do you take decisions only, you know, based on your father's opinion? How many of you take decisions based on your father's opinion? Most of you, am I right? But some of you may not only listen to your father, may also listen to your mother. Am I right? When father says, then you will go to mother. Then you will also go to your brother. Then you will also go to your sister. All of them are influencing your decision. That means your Y variable is dependent on many factors. Opinion, great influence, 50%. Mother's opinions, next level, 30%. Brother's opinion, 10%. Sister's opinion, 10%. Total 100% is divided. Where is the major influence? Father, major influence. That factor is most critical. The next importance, mother's opinion. Same way, what are the factors? What is the order of influence? Whichever is having a higher influence, that should be optimized so that major improvement can be obtained. All of you understand? There is no point, you know, changing a factor for a meager improvement in Y. Change a factor that can give you significant improvement. That significance is tested in p-value, and the influence also can be understood using the correlation and regression. See here, correlation and regression helps you to understand the relationship between X and Y. The condition required is X and Y should be continuous data. If X and Y are continuous, you can do correlation and regression, and that's it about hypothesis testing. Every single minute in our life is an hypothesis testing.